what this one was. ಇದು ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಬರಬೇಕಲ್ವಾ?
ಇಲ್ಲ ಸರ್, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಬರುತ್ತೆ.
ಹಾಂ,
ಅದರಲ್ಲೇ ಬರುತ್ತೆ ಸರ್. ನೀವು ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರೆ ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ನೀವು ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಹಾಕಿದ್ದೀರಾ?
ಇಲ್ಲ, ಹಾಕ್ಬೇಕೀಗ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ.
ಇಲ್ಲ, ಅದರಲ್ಲೇ ಮಾಡಿ ಸರ್, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ. ಅದು ಕನೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀರಲ್ಲ, ಅದೇ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಟ್
ಆಗುತ್ತೆ.
ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ನೀವು ಅದರಲ್ಲೇ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು
ಸರ್. ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಅಲ್ಲ, ನೋಡಿ ಚೆಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ.
ಓಕೆ, ನಾನು ಚೆಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ.
ಈಗ ನಾನು ರೆಕಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಶುರುವಾಗಿದೆಯಾ? ಹಲೋ, ಗುಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್ ಡಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ವಿಲ್ ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂ ವಿತ್ ದ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಹೌ ಯು ಆರ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ರಿಪೋರ್ಟ್ the microcytic hypochromic anemia and macrocytic anemia after seeing the peripheral smear. Okay, so before we go into the anemia of reporting and all those things, just let us have a look at the normal things of red cells and related things. So mature red cell is a circular biconcave disc containing pigmented protein called hemoglobin and is bound by the cell membrane. So on peripheral smear they appear as pale red cells with central one-third pallor. So you should remember that. So they appear as pale red cells with central one-third pallor. Okay, so where the upper and lower membrane surface closely meet, biconcave disc shaped. So coming to the normal parameters of red cells, one should know the normal parameters. The size of normal RBC ranges from 6.7 to 7.7 micrometer in diameter. So lifespan, all of you know, it is up to 120 days. Then coming to the indices, red cell indices. So they are very much needed. So when you are going to comment on the anemias, okay. So MCV, so mean corpuscular volume, so it is the average volume of red cell and is expressed in femtoliters. Then MCH, so mean corpuscular hemoglobin, so it represents average content of hemoglobin per red cell and it is expressed in picograms. Then MCHC, mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration, so it indicates the average concentration of hemoglobin in a given volume of packet cells and it is expressed in deciliter, gram per deciliter. And the fourth one is red cell distribution width. So it is a quantitative measure of the anisocytosis, that is variation in the shape and size of the RBCs. So and is expressed as percentage. So it is very important parameter in distinguishing the anemias. So let's see the normal range of red cell parameters, normal range at birth and in adult men and in adult women. So red cell count, as you all know, at birth is 5 to 7 millions per cubic millimeter. So the unit is millions per cubic millimeter. In men, healthy men, 4.5 to 5 millions, and in women 3.8 to 4.8. And hemoglobin at birth 14 to 22 gram per deciliter, and in men 13 to 17, and in women 12 to 15 gram per deciliter. packed cell volume, also called as hematocrit. So at birth it is 45% to 70%, and in men 40% to 50%, and in women 36% to 46%. Then reticulocyte count, the premature RBCs at birth 1% to 7%, and in men normal range is 0.5% to 2.5%, and in women also it is same. Then coming to the indices, so just now we have defined that indices. So MCV is 100 to 150, 120 femtoliters at birth. So in men and women of healthy adult, it is 82 to 100 femtoliters. MCH is 31 to 37 picograms, whereas in men and women it is 27 to 32. And MCHC in at birth it is 30 to 36 gram per deciliter, whereas in men and women it is 31 to 35 gram per deciliter. Okay. And RDW it is 13 to 18% at birth, whereas in men and women it is 11.5 to 14%. Okay. Then next, so after knowing the normal parameters, normal range of RBCs, now we'll go for the definition of anemia. So anemia is defined as the decrease below normal limit, that is below the reference level of age and sex of that particular individual, of the hemoglobin concentration, next erythrocyte count, that is RBC count, or PCV, okay, that is ratio of packed red cells to total blood volume, hematocrit or packed cell volume. So it can also be defined as a reduction of the total circulating red cell mass below the normal limits. So red cell mass is the volume of the red cells in the body. So normal in men is 26 to 32 ml per kg, and for women is 23 to 39 ml per kg. And functionally, so we can define anemia as a decrease in the oxygen carrying capacity of blood, which leads to tissue hypoxia. That means a reduction in the hemoglobin level and a reduction in the total circulating red cells. So functionally we define like that. Then, so per se anemia is not a disease, all of you know. So they present with various signs and symptoms. Okay, but it is the expression of underlying disease. From the treatment point of view, it is necessary to identify the cause of anemia. So patient, he may present with palpitation, tiredness, exertion on walking and all. So we have to find out, so what is the cause for anemia. Okay, so anemia may be absolute or a relative. So absolute means when there is decrease in the red cell mass, and relative means when it is associated with higher plasma volume. Example, in third trimester of pregnancy due to hemodilution, also called as spurious anemia, and it is not a disease state. Okay, but the term anemia is conventionally used for this absolute anemia, that is decrease in the red cell mass. Okay, so all of you in theory class, you got that classification of anemia and other things. So just here we see the morphological classification of anemia, that is into microcytic, normocytic and macrocytic. So micro means, as you all know, the normal size of the RBCs. So you are going to compare with a small lymphocyte. Okay, so if it is smaller than the small lymphocyte, then we call it as microcytic. So if it is more than the size of the small lymphocyte, then it is macrocytic. So microcytic hypochromic anemia. So what happens here, the size of the RBCs are smaller than the normal. Then central pallor, usually it is one third. So it is here, it's more than 1/3. So as the hemoglobin decreases, the central pallor increases. So according to that, the indices are also varies. So in microcytic, the mean cell corpuscular volume, it is reduced. So less than the normal range MCV. So less than 80 femtoliters. So MCHC is also reduced. Okay, example, iron deficiency anemia and thalassemias. So next, normocytic, normochromic anemia. Here, the size of the RBCs are normal and the central pallor in RBC is also normal, and MCV, MCHC, all other parameters are also normal. Example, during blood loss, anemia of chronic diseases. Then coming to third one, the macrocytic. So here the size of the RBCs, macro, large. So they are larger than the normal one. And central pallor in the RBCs is normal. So MCV and MCV is increased more than 100 femtoliters. So MCHC is normal here, because the hemoglobination is normal in macrocytes. So example, deficiency of vitamin B12 and folic acid. Then the general scheme of investigation of anemia. So normally when a patient comes to a physician, then he presents with the various signs and symptoms, and finally the clinician will make the provisional diagnosis. So he wants to confirm the diagnosis. So to confirm the diagnosis and to correlate, so he needs some of the investigations. So that is, first one is estimation of hemoglobin and packed red cells, okay, PCV and hematocrit. Then blood cell count, RBC, WBC and platelet counts. Then important investigation is peripheral smear examination. So here a pathologist will do the peripheral smear examination. So they will see the RBCs, WBCs and platelets for various parameters. And then next is red cell indices, then reticulocyte count, then ESR, and finally bone marrow examination. So these are the basic investigations one has to undergo in the evolution of anemia. Then coming to the grades of anemia, that is severity of anemia, you have mild, moderate and severe anemia. So mild anemia is when Hb level is 9.1 to 10.5 gram per deciliter, and moderate anemia is Hb is 6 to 9, and severe anemia is Hb less than 6 grams. Okay, so according to the percentage of hemoglobin, the severity of anemia is measured. Then coming to the first, iron deficiency anemia. So iron is required for the synthesis of normal heme of hemoglobin, and its deficiency leads to decreased erythropoiesis and anemia. So it is the most common nutritional disorder in the world. So coming to the laboratory findings, especially the peripheral blood, you have anemia, that is hemoglobin levels are decreased, usually in the range of 6 to 10 at the time of diagnosis. Then hematocrit is also decreased, and sometimes it may be much lower because of microcytic red cells. Then red cell indices, MCV, MCH and MCHC are all decreased below the normal reference range. And red cell distribution width is increased. So it is the earliest sign of iron deficiency erythropoiesis. Then coming to the peripheral smear findings, you have RBCs are microcytic and hyperchromic. So RBCs are small, micro, and hypochromic, hypo, less, chromia, that is color. So because of the decrease in the hemoglobin, so you're going to have the increased pallor, more than one third, that is hypochromic. So you have to see for these things in the peripheral smear. The red cells are smaller in diameter than the nucleus of a typical small lymphocyte. So you are going to compare the RBCs with the nucleus of a small lymphocyte. And if they are equal to that small lymphocyte, it is normocytic. If it is less than that, it is called as microcytic. And it is more than that, it is called macrocytic. Then you have to see for the degree of size, anisocytosis and poikilocytosis. So when there is a variation in the size and shape of the RBCs. So poikilocytosis is in the form of small elongated red cells. It may be a pencil shaped or cigar shaped cells, and is also a characteristic finding. Then WBCs, so total count are usually normal. Platelets, they may be normal or rise, especially if the anemia is associated with bleeding. Then occasionally a mixture of microcytic, hypochromic and macrocytic red cells are seen in the peripheral smear. So this is called as dimorphic blood picture, and it occurs in the mixed nutritional deficiency, that is iron deficiency as well as vitamin B12 or folic acid deficiency. Okay, so here the MCV and MCH may be misleadingly normal. So when hemoglobin is very less, then hematocrit is very less, and if you have this normal MCV and MCH, then one should look for dimorphic blood picture. So whether it is there or not, you have to comment. Then reticulocyte count, so it is low for the degree of anemia. See microcytic hypochromic cells. Then you have see the normal RBCs, and you can see the microcytic RBCs, and you can see the increased pallor where the arrow mark showing that increased pallor. Then you can see the mild degree of anisopoikilocytosis. You can see the cigar shaped cells or pencil shaped cells, all those things. Okay, so this is how you are going to see the microcytic hypochromic RBCs. So see the central pallor is increased. See, central pallor is increased. Central pallor is increased. Okay, so see the central pallor is increased. These are the pencil shaped cells. So this is the normal small lymphocyte, and this is the neutrophils, and these are the platelets. So you can see the platelets. Platelets are adequate. Coming to another important aspect in iron deficiency anemia is, one should know the serum iron profile in iron deficiency anemia. So once if you want to investigate properly, then you should know all these things. So one is serum ferritin. So usually in iron deficiency anemia, the serum ferritin is decreased. Okay, and serum iron, it is also decreased. And serum transferrin saturation, it is also decreased. Then fourth one is total plasma iron binding capacity, TIBC. So it is increased in iron deficiency anemia. Serum transferrin receptors, it is also increased. And red cell protoporphyrin is also increased. So serum ferritin, serum iron and serum transferrin saturations are decreased in iron deficiency anemia, whereas total plasma iron binding capacity, serum transferrin receptor and red cell protoporphyrin increased. So this is the serum iron profile in iron deficiency anemia. Then coming to the investigation of the cause of iron deficiency anemia. So usually this depends on the age, sex of the patient and also history and clinical findings. So in the absence of any significant features, the following investigations are performed to identify the chronic blood loss, especially from the GI tract. So especially in older people, if any other things are not identified, then you have to investigate the other important things like stool examination, endoscopy, radiological investigation, urine examination and all those things. Stool for occult blood and hookworm infestation. So it is very important to know the bleeding from the GI tract, chronic blood loss, occult blood and parasitic infestation. So that is hookworm infestation. Then endoscopy, so it includes upper gastrointestinal endoscopy, sigmoidoscopy and colonoscopy. So to know whether any abnormal mass or any chronic blood loss or any other diseases, you can definitely find out through the endoscopy. Then radiological investigations, that is barium meal and barium enema. Then urine examination, you can search for the schistosomiasis, parasite schistosomiasis. Then investigations for malabsorption. If there are features of malabsorption such as steatorrhea, relevant investigations has to be done to find out the cause. So these are some of the other special investigations. So in the cause of iron deficiency anemia. Then coming to the normal causes of microcytic hypochromic anemia. So one is iron deficiency anemia. The second one is thalassemia major, where the RBCs are microcytic hypochromic blood picture. So if RBCs are microcytic hypochromic in the peripheral blood picture, then you can think of all these possibilities. One is iron deficiency anemia. Second one is thalassemia major. So that is presents with features of hemolytic anemia and hepatosplenomegaly. Iron stores are increased. So thalassemia minor also produces this microcytic hypochromic blood picture. Then one has to rule out the anemia of chronic disorders. So that is clinical features of underlying these disorders are present and iron stores are either normal or increased. Then another one, sideroblastic anemia. You have to rule out sideroblastic anemia. Then other causes include alcohol, lead poisoning and drugs. So these are the differential diagnosis of this microcytic hypochromic anemia. If if you get a microcytic hypochromic anemia, then they might ask you what are the other causes of microcytic hypochromic anemia. So other than iron deficiency anemia, that is most common, so you have to tell thalassemia, then anemia of chronic disorders, sideroblastic anemia, all those things, they show the picture of microcytic hypochromic anemia. Then coming to another important nutritional anemia, that is megaloblastic anemia. So here in peripheral blood picture, so we give it as macrocytic anemia. So usually we don't give in the peripheral blood picture impression megaloblastic. So in the peripheral blood picture impression is macrocytic anemia. Okay, so if you ask the causes, then we can tell whether it is a megaloblastic anemia or a non-megaloblastic anemia. Okay, so recently in practicals, so many of you have written in the impression megaloblastic anemia. No, you should not do like that. So So in the impression, you have to write macrocytic anemia. Then in the discussion, so as I told you, the different causes of microcytic hypochromic anemia. So like that, so different causes of macrocytic anemia, then you can tell one by one whether it is a megaloblastic in origin or non-megaloblastic. So the cause of macrocytic anemia may be broadly divided into megaloblastic or non-megaloblastic. So depending on the appearance of a developing red cell, precursors in the bone marrow, that is megaloblast. So megaloblastic anemia are characterized by the presence of abnormal red cell precursors in the bone marrow. So as of you, everybody knows, in the bone marrow, the abnormal cell is megaloblast. So megaloblastic anemia are diverse group of anemias characterized by impaired DNA synthesis and distinct morphological changes in hematopoietic cells because of the deficiency of vitamin B12 and folic acid. Okay, let's see the common features of this megaloblast, which is present in the bone marrow. Cell size is larger than the normoblast, and chromatin is sieve-like chromatin, more open, and dissociation of cytoplasmic and nuclear maturation. So nuclear maturation lags behind the cytoplasmic maturation. So because of impaired DNA synthesis, there is nuclear maturation lags behind. So but in the cytoplasm, normal hemoglobination is there, but only the nuclear maturation lags behind. Okay, so that you should know. That's why in macrocytic anemia you don't see the pallor as you see in the microcytic anemia. That is the main reason. So marrow shows increased proportion of more primitive erythroid cells when you do the bone marrow aspiration. Okay, let's come to the findings in megaloblastic anemia, peripheral blood smear examination. So hemoglobin, usually it is decreased at the range of 5 to 10, and hematocrit is also decreased, and one should look for the red cell indices. Here, as we told you, it is macrocytic, the volume is bigger, larger. So mean corpuscular volume is above the normal range. So normal range is 80 to 98, and it is above 100 femtoliters. So that is very, very important finding. Okay, mean corpuscular volume, MCV, is above the normal range. Then hemoglobin content in the red cell is proportionately increased because of normal cytoplasmic maturation, and therefore MCHC remains normal. So see, that is very important. MCHC is remain normal. So MCH is increased. So MCV and MCH are increased, whereas MCHC is normal in macrocytic anemia of megaloblastic origin. So RBCs, so when you look for the RBCs, they are variable in size, with majority being macrocytic and oval macrocytic. Macro ovalocytes are the diagnostic feature of megaloblastic anemia in the peripheral smear. So macrocytes are larger in diameter because of the more volume than thickness and volume. So because macrocytes are thicker and well hemoglobinized, most macrocytes lack the central pallor of normal red cells, and they can even appear hyperchromic. So sometimes you may not see the normal central pallor also. So that is because of this well hemoglobinized cell. Then there is marked variation in the size and shape of the red cells. So together, usually we call it as anisopoikilocytosis. So So anisopyknocytosis means the variation in the size and shape of the RBCs. Then evidence of dyserythropoiesis may be seen, like, you know, in the form of basophilic stippling. Okay, they appear as blue-black cytoplasmic inclusions. Okay, so they appear as blue-black cytoplasmy. The first one, they appear as blue-black cytoplasmic inclusions. And they represent precipitated ribosomal RNA. Then Howell-Jolly bodies are nuclear remnants and may be observed in few red cells. And Cavort rings, which in the form of figure of 8, they stain pink blue and represent nuclear remnants. See, so this is the Cavort rings in the figure of 8. Nuclear remnants, and here also Howell-Jolly bodies. Then reticulocyte count is either normal or low. Then coming to the WBCs, so here you have the cells are decreased. Sometimes you can see the leukopenia and show hypersegmented neutrophils with 5 to 6 or more nuclear lobes, hypersegmented neutrophils. Their presence is the first and specific morphological sign of megaloblastic anemia. So such neutrophils are also larger than the normal. So macro polymorphonuclear cells. Then platelets usually decreased and may vary, sometimes normal or decreased. See the macrocytes. See, you cannot see the central pallor also. Okay, so these are the macrocytes. So RBCs are macrocytic. See, macro ovulocytes with hypersegmented neutrophils. So this is normal RBCs. These are the platelets. Okay, so you can see the macro ovulocytes. Already I have to basophilic stippling and Cavort rings and Howell-Jolly bodies. Then coming to the causes of non-megaloblastic macrocytic anemia. So megaloblastic, that is because of the deficiency of vitamin B12 and folic acid. But in non-megaloblastic, we have the physiological causes. You can see in pregnancy, you can see in newborn, and pathological causes. You can see in alcoholic excess, chronic liver disease, reticulocytosis, hypothyroidism, post-splenectomy, and myeloproliferative disorders. And hematological disorders, where you can see all these things. Aplastic anemia, sideroblastic anemia, then pure red cell aplasia, drug induced, all those things are the causes of non-megaloblastic macrocytic anemia. Okay, now coming to some of the important things, how we are going to approach to this microcytic and macrocytic anemia and normal peripheral reporting and all those things. Some 3 to 4 slides are there, just I will show you. See, investigation. So once, if you see the peripheral smear finding, and the peripheral smear finding shows the picture of microcytic hypochromic anemia, and there is a decrease in the MCV, then you can do serum ferritin. So once you do the serum ferritin, if the serum ferritin is decreased, then it is 100% sure that that is anemia, that is microcytic hypochromic anemia, is because of iron deficiency. Okay, so the serum ferritin, if it is normal, then look for the target cells and basophilic stippling in the peripheral smear, then you do hemoglobin electrophoresis, and if you know HbA2 if it is normal, then you can say it is anemia of chronic diseases or sideroblastic anemia. So if you want to rule out that, do bone marrow iron studies. So there is increased storage of iron, then it is anemia of chronic diseases. If you see the ring sideroblast, then it is anemia is sideroblastic anemia. If HbA2 is increased, then there is increase in the fetal hemoglobin. When you do the hemoglobin electrophoresis, then you can think of alpha or beta thalassemia. So this is how, in a simple way, you can approach. Once in a peripheral smear, if you report it as microcytic anemia, okay, so you have to rule out whether it is because of the iron deficiency or whether it is because of sideroblastic anemia or it is because of thalassemia. Okay, in same way for macrocytic anemia, it is there. So once in a peripheral smear, so if you see the macrocytes, then MCV is high, macrocytic anemia, clinical clues are patient is alcoholic or they have a liver disease or previous abdominal surgery, and then ask for any hypothyroidism history, drug history, all those things. Then do a reticulocyte count. So if reticulocyte count is normal or low, then in the peripheral smear, then you look for these macro-ovulocytes and hypersegmented neutrophils. If you see macro-ovulocytes and hypersegmented neutrophils and reticulocyte count is normal, then you can think of megaloblastic anemia, that is because of decreased folate and vitamin B12. So in the peripheral smear, if you see oval macrocytes, then you can think of non-megaloblastic picture causes like liver disease, alcoholism or hypothyroidism. Then if you see round macrocytes, then this hematopoiesis, then you can think of myelodysplastic syndrome. Okay, then if reticulocyte count is very high, higher than the normal range, then in peripheral smear you look for the polychromasia and evidence of hemolysis. So that's why reticulocyte count is very, very important investigation. So if it is normal, then you can think of megaloblastic and non-megaloblastic picture. If it is high, then you can think of hemolytic blood picture. Okay, so hemolytic anemia or bleeding. Okay, so in these simple ways you can approach for microcytic or macrocytic anemia. Okay, now coming to some of the normal things. So last practical exams, people have not done properly in a methodological way, then let's see how to examine the peripheral blood smear. Okay, a well prepared peripheral smear usually has three parts, namely head, body and tail. The best area of the smear to study the morphology of cells is the body, where the cells are well separated out and evenly distributed without any overlapping. Then apply a thin layer of oil over the smear, which makes the appearance of cells very clear. Then first look for under low power, followed by high power. So look whether the peripheral smear is stained properly or not, whether the distribution is properly or not. And next, in the high power, you just select the area where the RBCs are evenly distributed. Then you go to oil immersion and then observe for the following things: the quality of the film and uniformity of the staining. Then observe the RBCs. So how? Again, same thing, select an area that is best between the tail and body of the smear, suitable for examination of the red cells. And you look for the number, distribution and staining of the red cells, the degree of Rolex formation if present. Then look for the WBCs. In WBCs, what you are going to comment? You are going to comment on the number of WBCs, whether they are adequate or not. Then distribution of the WBCs and the morphology of the WBCs. Then platelets, you have to comment on the number and whether they are adequate or more or less. Then the another important thing is you have to comment on the hemoparasites. Okay. Then any other abnormal cells. So in a peripheral blood smear examination, so you have to comment on all the things. So you have to comment on the red cells, you have to comment on the white cells, platelets, hemoparasites and any other abnormal cells. So in RBCs, what are you going to comment and what are you going to see or observe? That is one for the size of the RBCs, whether they are microcytic, normocytic or macrocytic. Then shape, any abnormal shape, anisopyclocytosis. Then color, chromic, chromia, whether it is normochromic, hypochromic or hyperchromic. And whether any inclusions are there or not, and any other abnormalities. So these are the, you know, five parameters you have to keep in mind, and you have to observe the RBCs. Then white cells. So they are examined for the following features. One is number. Note whether the number is decreased, normal or increased. How? You have to assess the approximate total white cell count. How? By observing at least 10 high power fields in the thick portion of the smear where RBCs are overlapped. So estimate the approximate number of RBCs per high power field. So each 10 high power field. So each field, so approximately it is equivalent to 2000 WBCs per cubic millimeter. Okay. So accordingly, so we have to count and we have to comment whether the count is normal, decreased or increased. Then you have to comment on the abnormal or immature forms. Any immature forms like, you know, myeloblasts, promyelocytes, myelocytes, metamyelocytes, band forms, whether any shift to left. So immature cells, if you see, you have to comment on the immature cells. Then you have to comment on the predominant cell type. So which is the predominant cell which is there in the peripheral smear? So for that you have to do differential leukocyte count, DC, DLC, differential leukocyte count. So at least 100 WBCs you have to count. So in 100 WBCs, so you have to see what is the percentage of individual WBCs. So depending upon the percentage of individual WBCs, then you should know the normal things and whether it is increased or decreased. So these are the normal range of WBCs when you do the differential count, and you have to keep it this normal range in your mind. That is neutrophils 40 to 70%, eosinophils 1 to 6%, basophils 0 to 1%, lymphocytes 20 to 40%, monocyte 2 to 10%. So suppose if you do the DC and if you get a neutrophil count of 80%, then definitely we can say it is neutrophilia. Neutrophils are more than the normal range. So you, like that, you, whether you should see whether neutropenia is there, neutrophilia is there, eosinophilia is there or not, basophilia, then lymphopenia, lymphocytosis, like that you have to see. By doing the DC, you will come to know whether the distribution is normal or abnormal. Okay. Then coming to, so like that in WBCs, you have to comment on the normal count, then distribution and morphology. So these three things you keep it in mind. You have to comment in normal peripheral blood picture, you have to comment and you have to write the normal things. Okay. Then coming to the platelets. A single platelet under oil immersion is equivalent to 15 to 20,000 platelets per cubic millimeter. So like that, you have to examine under oil immersion and you have to comment whether platelets are adequate or not. Okay. Then number, whether platelets are increased or decreased. Then note for the size and shape of the platelets. Okay. Sometimes you can see giant platelets. Then aggregation, smear made from finger prick shows aggregation of platelets or platelet clumps. So in that case, sometimes you may see erroneous results in the machine. Okay. So that is because of the aggregation of platelets. Then you have to comment on the hemoparasites. So you have to keep in mind, and it's a famous question also. So what are hemoparasites? Name them, like, you know, malaria, microfilaria, trypanosomes, Leishmania, Donovani, and babesiosis. Then format for reporting peripheral blood smear. So as I told you all the things, again you can look for these things. So normocytic, microcytic, macrocytic, chromasia, whether it is normochromic, hypochromic, or absence of central pallor. Then you have to comment on the anisocytosis, whether it is present or absent. So whether it is mild degree, moderate degree, or severe degree. So you can comment moderate degree of anisopyclocytosis is there. So severe degree of anisopyclocytosis seen, like that. So then you have to comment on any other abnormal cells, like, you know, spherocytes, sickle cells, target cells, like that. Then you have to comment on the polychromatophilia. So we have to plus comment whether polychromatophils are there or not. Then you have to comment on the nucleated red cells. So when you comment on the nucleated red cells, you have to comment how many the normoblasts per 100 leukocytes. Then, as I told you, same thing, WBCs, you have to comment whether they are in normal count or distribution and morphology. Platelets also same thing, and hemoparasites. So that is how we are going to do the normal things. So in a normal peripheral smear, so one should appreciate the normal things like RBCs are normocytic and normochromic, mild anisocytosis seen, no abnormal cells seen, WBCs are normal in number, morphology and distribution, platelets are adequate in number, no hemoparasites seen. So that is how you have to, you know, write the normal peripheral smear. Okay. So I will upload the picture of microcytic hypochromic anemia and the macrocytic. You have to write in your record, neat labeled diagram. Okay. So don't forget to write in a normal reporting form. So in exams, you have to write the normal in a normal format. So we have seen so many of you have not followed the normal format of reporting of peripheral blood picture. So study properly, see these PPTs once again, and you know, read properly. Okay, thank you.